Hello friends, welcome back. In this session, we are going to discuss about types of autopsy. The term autopsy has been derived from the ancient Greek word autopsia. Autos means self, apes, view. So autopsy means to see for oneself or simply self-examination. In practice, autopsy has been defined as scientific dissection of the dead body. So what are the types of autopsy? The first and the most important one is the medico-legal autopsy. Students, please remember that medico-legal autopsy is the most common type of autopsy in India. Then there is pathological autopsy, there is anatomical autopsy, etc. In virtual, psychological and verbal autopsies, actually no dissection carried out. Then there are obscure and active autopsies also. Before discussing these different types of autopsies, I would like to caution that some pictures, some slides may be disturbing for some viewers. So, viewers' discretion advised. Let's begin with the medico-legal autopsy, the most common type of autopsy. It is otherwise known as forensic autopsy or necropsy. You know, necros means dead, opis means view. Again, examination of the dead body. Then, thanatopsy. Thanatos means death, and sexio cadaveris, or postmortem examination. Post means after, mortem means death. This postmortem examination is a very common layman term, often denotes this medico-legal autopsy only. But this term lacks precision because in some countries, some bodies are disposed of with only external examination, without dissection being done. In such a situation also, the procedure is called postmortem examination. So how to define medico-legal autopsy? It is the investigating scientific dissection of the dead body with a view to searching primarily for the cause of death. So main objective of medico-legal autopsy is to ascertain the cause of death of the deceased. Which circumstances it is carried out? It is done in all sudden, suspicious and obscure deaths. Suspicious means if there is any doubt regarding the manner of death, that is suicide, homicide, accident, etc. And obscure deaths. Obscure means that the cause of death cannot be clearly made out. Then to establish the cause of death, medico-legal autopsy can be done. Then an unnatural death, that is suicidal, homicidal or accidental deaths. All these type of deaths, autopsy should be compulsorily done. Then, going to other facts about the medico-legal autopsy, the medico-legal autopsy has to be done only on legal authorization or permission from the concerned authorities. Normally, it is the police will issue the requisition to the autopsy surgeon for performing autopsy. The police officer is called IO, that is investigating officer of the case. Normally, the sub-inspector will act as an IO in most of the cases. In Tamil Nadu, head constable and above rank police officer can act as an IO. Whereas in murder cases and all, circuit inspector will act as an IO. In certain situations, executive magistrate will issue an order for performing autopsy. So, unless the proper authorization is given for the doctor, doctor should not start the autopsy, though body may be waiting in the mortuary. As it is being done only under legal authorization or legal permission, consent of the next of kin or close relatives not at all required. Even they don't have right for refusal also, because the dead body in case of medico-legal cases is in the possession of the respective state, and it is the duty of the state to protect the rights of the deceased person. Suppose the deceased has been murdered by someone, it is the duty of the state to conduct the trial in that case and to get conviction of the accused. Since law itself provides consent in medico-legal cases, for medico-legal autopsy, the consent of the next of kin is not at all required. Then who will conduct autopsy? It should preferably be done by a forensic medicine expert, that is a doctor with a specialization in the forensic medicine subject. Because of inadequate number of forensic medicine experts in India, any allopathic registered medical practitioners called RMPs with a MBBS degree are eligible to conduct autopsy. Students, Please note that only allopathic doctors are permitted, not homeopathy or Siddha registered medical practitioners. Other fact is, after completing your MBBS degree, you are eligible to conduct autopsy in the authorized centers. And you are competent to give evidence also later in the court as a subject expert. Then, where it is to be, it is done only in the authorized autopsy centers. Only in the government authorized centers. In Tamil Nadu, so many primary health centers, government taluk hospitals, district headquarter hospitals, they are equipped with the autopsy facilities. The autopsy centers are there. Whereas, in case of private institutions, as far as Tamil Nadu is concerned, as a policy, the Tamil Nadu government is not giving permission for running the or starting the autopsy center. Only the Ramachandra Medical College at Porur, Chennai, that is given permission. Otherwise, as far as medical legal autopsy is concerned, in Tamil Nadu, no private institutions are permitted to start autopsy. Now, as far as this medical legal autopsy is concerned, the autopsy should be complete. That means with the opening of all the cavities, cranial cavity, thoracic cavity, and abdominal cavity, and with the inspection of all the internal organs, that complete autopsy should be done. Partial autopsy, like opening of particular cavity only, that is not permitted in case of medical legal autopsy. So after autopsy is over, the doctor has to hand over the body, not to the relatives, to the IO, that is investigating officer only. Usually the constable who is in charge of the deceased body will receive the autopsied body. The doctor has to get the signature in the register also. That police will later hand over the body to the relatives. So here the fact we have to know is, in case of medical legal autopsy, body has to be handed over to the police, not the relatives. As I said already, the medical legal autopsy is made compulsory by the law. The relatives don't have any role either to give consent or refuse consent for autopsy. In this incident in Andhra Pradesh hospital, a suicide victim has been brought dead to the hospital there in Nandya. The relatives of the deceased, they don't want the body to be cut during postmortem. So they hurriedly take away the body in a bike, and the police are receiving the intimation. They chased the persons who are riding the bike with the body. They brought them back and the autopsy has been conducted. And no case has been in this situation has been booked, but it is an unlawful one. Coming to the second type of autopsy, that is a pathological autopsy, otherwise known as clinical, hospital, or academic autopsy. It is not so common like a medical legal autopsy. When it is done is non-emergency cases, whereas medical legal autopsy is done in medical legal cases, this is done in non-medical legal cases, especially the natural death that is occurring in the hospital. Since it is done in natural death, no legal issues are involved. Who will conduct it? It is generally has to be better done by the pathologist and the physician, or sometimes even the treating physician himself can conduct this pathological autopsy. What for it is done? Suppose if the treating clinician is not sure of his diagnosis, or to confirm the diagnosis he has made, or to know the extent of disease spread in the deceased. Suppose in a cancer patient, how much involvement of the internal organs, the disease spread has occurred. To find out that, he can perform this pathological autopsy. It is a type of academic autopsy only, and it is done to mainly to enrich his medical knowledge, clinical knowledge, which will help further while treating similar patients in the future. As well as for research purpose also, he can perform this autopsy. So main objective is to understand the disease process that led to the death of the patient. And unlike this medical legal autopsy, pathological autopsy can be done in any place, any hospital with the adequate facilities for the procedure. Here, just since it is the non-emergency case, the consent or permission from the legal heir, that is sufficient. No, this authorization from the police or magistrate here, okay. Then partial or complete autopsy, as per the doctor wish, can be done. Normally, partial autopsy to open the specific body cavity where the disease process lies. After inspection, the doctor will close that particular opened cavity and hand over the body to the relatives. Okay. If necessary, complete autopsy can be done. But for either complete or partial autopsy, and if any ancillary investigations like histopathology examinations or lab investigations required, the doctor can do that also. But for everything, doctor has to explain to the next of kin and get the consent. According to the consent only, whether partial or total autopsy, ancillary investigations, etc. have to be done. Here, important fact is, after autopsy is over, body should be handed over to the same relatives only who has given consent. Not unlike this medical legal autopsy where it is to be given to the police. So these are the differences between the medical legal autopsy and the pathological autopsy. Third type is the anatomical autopsy. Students, this is you have already done this anatomical autopsy. It is a form of academic autopsy only. It is generally done by the anatomist, the students of medicine, allied health sciences, etc., for the purpose of understanding the human anatomy. Okay. So here also no legal issues involved. Suppose a person has voluntarily donated his body for anatomical autopsy after his death, then only with the consent of the next of kin or the legal heirs of the deceased, the anatomical autopsy should be done. If the relatives object for anatomical autopsy, for handing over the body to the academic institutions, though the deceased has expressed his willingness while he was alive, if the relatives refuse, it should not be performed. Fourth type is the virtual autopsy. In short, vertopsy. That is vert from virtual and autopsy from autopsy. Combinedly called vertopsy in short form, or digital autopsy also. It is a newer type of autopsy, and this is based on using the imaging techniques like a multi-slice computer tomography, magnetic resonance imaging, 3D surface scanner, etc. Using all these sophisticated instruments, without dissection, we can examine the diseased body to find out the cause of death. So many countries like Switzerland, Canada, UK, Germany, Sri Lanka, Singapore, Malaysia, etc., and Middle East countries also, this is being done. So here, as you are seeing, the body is cleanly packed or covered with the proper material and put into the CT or MRI machine, and the images are analyzed. A CT scan will generate around 25,000 cross-sectional images per second, and this process can be completed within usually 10 minutes. So there is here, this is the surface scanner for studying the lesions or injuries pertaining to body surface. Then a CT scan will evaluate bony lesions and all. Then tissue lesions, injuries, etc. can be measured by MRI better. So by combination of all the this imaging techniques, it is being done. Hence it is otherwise called a digital autopsy also. And the images from those scanning machines are relayed to the virtual autopsy table, as you are seeing here, which helps to study the external and internal findings. In India, the March of this year, 2021, at AIIMS New Delhi, the Forensic Medicine Department, the first autopsy, that virtual autopsy center has been started. And currently the pilot project is going on. Yet there is no legal sanction for virtual autopsy in India. These are the merits and demerits of virtual autopsy. So important merits will be it is less time consuming. This time of COVID pandemic, the risk of exposure to infection in case of like a normal routine autopsy, it is avoided here. And this data can be stored in the digital format. It can be later reproduced in the court for perusal by the judges and all. Or signed opinion, third opinion, etc. can be obtained by sending the data digitally through mail, etc. to any other forensic expert anywhere in the world. So these are some important merits of this digital autopsy. Another important one is it respect the religious sentiments of certain communities who don't want the incisions or cuts on the deceased body. So for sentimental purpose, it can be done. Coming to demerits, it is a very costly procedure and it requires a highly sophisticated environment with the appointment of radiologists, technicians, etc. They also should be well trained. Even the forensic medicine expert also should have been given training, etc. And being the digital form of assessing the findings, it has so many demerits. Like in case of a decomposition, interpretation of findings will be difficult. And to differentiate between antemortem and postmortem findings digitally, it will be very difficult. And certain postmortem artifacts or artifacts, that is a feature introduced to the dead body after death, they also cannot be properly appreciated. And another demerit is, though it has been started in the AIIMS recently, it has no legal validity in India yet. So this digital autopsy can be considered as an adjunct to medical legal autopsy because of a lot of demerits with respect to this digital autopsy. It cannot be act as a substitute for medical legal autopsy. Always the medical legal autopsy is the superior and considered as the gold standard method. Next one is the psychological autopsy, otherwise called a retrospective death assessment, reconstructive evaluation, equivocal death analysis, etc. Though it is called autopsy, as I said already, there is no dissection involved here. It is done in a case of alleged suicide which has been committed under mysterious circumstances or no suicidal note left by the victim, etc. Then to find out the motive behind the act, to find out the mental state of the deceased person before commission of the suicide, it is done. That is called a psychological autopsy. How it is done is by conducting a structured interview of family members whoever we believe can give some information about the mental condition of the deceased prior to this commission of suicide, like interviewing his close family members, close friends, his teachers, physicians, doctors, then perusal of police records, his personal diaries, then various social media accounts, etc., which will provide light regarding the mental state of the person who has committed suicide. So after analyzing all this data that has been recorded, we can come to the idea. What is the cause for commission of this act? Whether it is due to any mental condition or physical condition, etc. So, one of the objectives is to find out the motive behind the commission of the act. Then we can confirm whether it is actually a suicide or any chance of accidental or homicide is there. Homicidal manner of death. Like, suppose a person has taken some drugs, whether it is a suicidal ingestion or any accidental overdose. Based on the psychological autopsy, we can somewhat confirm this fact. And to understand the suicidal behavior of people, to formulate the strategy for preventing suicide, etc., this psychological autopsy, the data recovered will be helpful. It is not commonly done in India. These are all certain recent sensational cases where the psychological autopsy has been done. Next one is the verbal autopsy, in short called VA. This is being conducted only in the natural deaths and in those cases where cause of death is not known. It is done by going to the respective places and conducting a protocoled interview of family members, caregivers, etc. to understand the clinical features, that is signs and symptoms in the patient that prevails prior to the death, to understand the cause of death based on the clinical features preceding the death. This is generally done in circumstances where the patient has not been brought to the hospital, hospital records of cause of death are not clear or available, etc. So, by conducting structured interviews of family members and asking questions regarding the clinical features preceding the death, we somewhat determine the probable cause of death. So, in a community, suppose a lot of deaths are happening over a period of time, by doing a verbal autopsy of all the deceased families, we can classify the deaths based on the clinical features. And with the classification, we can make out what is the most common disease, or it could be any communicable disease also prevailing in that community. So with the data available, we can formulate strategy to prevent the diseases, especially communicable diseases, etc., that is affecting the community, and to improve the health of the people in a particular community, this verbal autopsy will be helpful. Generally, it is done to know the neonatal mortality based on the causes of death, infant mortality, maternal mortality, etc. So, what are the illnesses, diseases that causing the death in a community? Seventh type is the obscure autopsy. It accounts for some 20% of medical legal autopsies in India. As the name suggests, the gross examination won't show any definite findings regarding the cause of death. So with the gross external and internal examination, the autopsy surgeon cannot make out any specific diagnosis of cause of death because the findings are so minimal or very absent. But subsequent ancillary investigations like histopathological, microbiological, serological, toxicological and other lab investigations like any electrolyte disturbances, etc., that will establish the cause of death. Such type of autopsies are called obscure autopsy. So in obscure autopsy, postmortem findings will be very minimal or obscure, but the ancillary investigations will establish the cause of death. Last type is the negative autopsy, which accounts for just 2-5% of medical legal autopsies. Here, not only the postmortem findings, even the ancillary investigations, they also fail to establish the cause of death. So, the autopsy surgeon, even with ancillary investigations, he cannot make out any cause of death. Such type of autopsies should be classified as negative autopsies. So, these are the causes for obscure as well as negative autopsies. And these negative autopsies are more common in case of advanced decomposition, where the postmortem findings as well as ancillary investigations become negative commonly because of the advanced decomposition. Then functional failures like epilepsy, stroke, etc., where there is no obvious gross anatomical findings, we can make it out. Then biochemical disturbances like hyperglycemia, hypo and hyperkalemia, uremia, etc. Then endocrine disorders like adrenal insufficiency, thyrotoxicosis, eczema. Then considered trauma like concussion of brain, blunt injury to the heart. There is changes in the morphology in these conditions of the brain or heart, etc. Then various cardiac anomalies like coronary artery spasm, death due to cardiac arrhythmias, conduction disorders like Wolff-Parkinson-White syndrome, etc. Then poisonings due to anesthetic overdose, delayed narcotic poisonings, certain neurotoxic and cytotoxic poisons, and certain rare poisons, these investigations, everything will turn out to be negative. Then miscellaneous conditions like reflex vagal inhibition of heart due to various causes, then incompatible or mismatched blood transfusion, air embolism, anaphylactic deaths, and extreme menstruation, etc. Coming to medical legal importance of negative autopsy, the doctor cannot make out with the cross examination and lab investigation also turn out to be negative, then if he cannot arrive at any specific cause of death, then the doctor should not hesitate to give opinion as no opinion can be given regarding cause of death or cause of death is uncertain. And these negative autopsies without any definite opinion regarding the cause of death is acceptable legally in the court. Here I want to mention that whenever a well-established postmortem procedure, technique or answering investigations and all, they are not properly done, either due to ignorance or lack of training or skill or non-availability of resources, etc. If the cause of death cannot be established, then such autopsies should be called defective autopsies, not negative autopsy. So defective autopsies are those due to these inadequate techniques, lack of skill on the part of autopsy surgeons, not specimens not properly preserved, etc. Let us try this MCQ. Consent of the legal heir is not necessary for dead body donation, organ donation, medical legal autopsy, clinical autopsy. When the consent is not required, so it is very simple, it is the medical legal autopsy. The body after medical legal autopsy is handed over to the, so to whom we have to hand over the body after autopsy? Police constable, relatives, RMO, court. So it has to be handed over to the investigating officer or police constable in charge of the deceased body in case of medical legal autopsy. Whereas in case of pathological autopsy, as we have discussed already, it has to be handed over to the relatives. The most common type of autopsy in India is the anatomical autopsy, medical legal autopsy, pathological autopsy, vertopsy. So most common type is naturally the medical legal autopsy. So thank you friends. We will meet you in the next session with another topic. Bye.